on our agenda, which is the situation of the Roma. The situation of the Roma population in Europe and related issues. I think that you will know last year the Council of Europe said that we needed to give serious attention to this issue. There was an initiative of Secretary General Jagland to convene a high-level meeting of government representatives on the Roma issue. That meeting took place here in Strasbourg in October, and the Strasbourg Declaration was adopted. We also know, of course, that many European municipalities and regions are actively pursuing initiatives in favour of Roma integration. And a number of existing municipal networks are taking up the issue as well. Perhaps I could mention inclusive cities, Euro cities, intercultural cities, the Strasbourg Club, and many, many local authorities are expressing an interest to become more involved in these activities. The objective of our debate today is to discuss the challenges which we're faced in local and regional authorities with. For several years, can I remind you that the Congress has been organising the DOSTA Congress Prize for municipalities to reward local communities for their innovative projects aimed at integration of the Roma community and in fighting discrimination against that community. The third edition of this prize is being organised this year. I'd also remind you that in December the Bureau reappointed Mr. John Warmersham of the United Kingdom as the rapporteur on this issue, and I'm very pleased to welcome him to this debate. We are also very pleased to have three guest speakers who will take part in the debate. Mr. Schockenberg is with us, who's already given a presentation to the Bureau. He's the special representative of the Secretary General on Roma issues. Professor Rudolf Sarkozy is with us, who's president, president of the Advisory Council of Roma National Minorities, and also has a great experience in local government as a former district councillor of Vienna. And then also Ms. Pilar Varela Diaz, the mayor of Avilés in Spain, and her city has been running a project involving many aspects of Roma integration for several years now. So our three speakers are very, very welcome. First of all, I'd like to invite Mr. Schockenbrook to address us. As you know, Secretary General Jagland appointed him as his special representative and put him in charge of the organisation of our transversal work to promote the integration of Roma communities. And Mr. Schockenbrook is a key partner for the Congress in the organisation and implementation of our activities, and is involved in co-organising the third edition for the prize that I've mentioned. So you're very welcome, Mr. Schockenbrook, and the floor is yours, please.
Mr. President, members of the Congress, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to begin by thanking you, Mr. President, for giving me the honour to address this distinguished body today. And I congratulate the Congress with its decision to hold a current affairs debate on the situation of Roma in Europe and the challenges for local and regional authorities. I hope and trust that this timely debate will mark the beginning of a new era, an era of strong, concerted and, above all, determined efforts by local and regional authorities in Europe to radically improve the desperate situation of the Roma in many parts of our continent. Roma communities face huge problems in accessing healthcare, employment. They face substandard housing conditions, segregated and low-quality schooling for Roma children, forced evictions and acts of hostility, violence and hate speech, including from politicians at national and local level. The universality of human rights, including social rights and the prohibition of discrimination, often remains a theory that is not applied to the Roma. This state of affairs is not new, but the current economic crisis risks seriously aggravating the situation. There is no need for me to dwell much longer on the deplorable situation many Roma in Europe find themselves in. There exists an overwhelming body of evidence from Council of Europe, European Union, OSCE and NGO sources that amply documents the situation. The real question is, what are we going to do about it? Yes, there have been efforts by and within Member States, but as the Council of Europe Commissioner for Human Rights has said, progress has been very modest and very slow. It is high time for action. This is the main message that the Strasbourg Declaration of last October sends to all stakeholders, not least to local and regional authorities in Member States. It is no longer possible to close our eyes to this situation and simply assume that the problems will go away. They won't. They will only get worse unless action is taken. We cannot afford to wait. It is high time for determined and robust action, including by local and regional authorities, to radically improve the situation. I will come back to the role of local and regional authorities, but allow me first to give you a brief sketch of action undertaken by the Council of Europe itself. The high-level meeting on Roma, as you said, Mr. President, convened at the initiative of the Secretary-General with strong support of the Commission Vice President Reding, led to the adoption of the Strasbourg Declaration, in which the governments of Member States agreed on the list of priorities. Priorities which should guide action, in the first place, action by and within the Member States themselves. But the Strasbourg Declaration also gives important direction to the role and work of the Council of Europe in this area. It welcomes the Secretary-General's decision to reorganise resources in the Secretariat in a transversal manner. My own appointment as Special Representative of the Secretary-General for Roma issues must be seen in this context, but also in the context of stronger coordination on Roma issues within the Council of Europe Secretariat internally as well as externally in coordination with other international organisations, especially the EU, the OSCE and with civil society, including the European Roma and Travellers Forum. The declaration also emphasises the need for further cooperation on collecting, analysing and exchanging information on policies and good practice on Roma within Member States. Exchanges of information at all levels, national, regional, local and international. We are currently developing an electronic database to collect such information from a wide range of sources and make it much more easily accessible for all stakeholders, not least regions and municipalities that can draw inspiration from policies and initiatives that have proved to be useful in other parts of Europe or even in the same country. The Committee of Ministers has recently created an Intergovernmental Committee of Experts on Roma issues, the CARROM, whose main task is precisely to analyse and evaluate policies and practices within Member States so as to identify good practice and to share lessons learned. The Congress has been invited to participate in this new committee, and I am delighted that your rapporteur, Mr. Warmersham, has been appointed as your representative. In addition, the declaration states the agreement of Member States to set up a European training programme for Roma mediators. In the past 3 months, the curriculum and concept for this programme, the ROMED programme, have been developed, and a first round of in-country training sessions has already started. Roma mediators are persons, usually Roma, employed to facilitate, in an impartial manner, communication and contact between the local Roma community and public authorities and services at the local level. Experience has shown that their work can make a real difference. Improving access by Roma families to healthcare, increasing school attendance by Roma children, better access for Roma to employment services and vocational training, etc. Under the ROMED programme, the Council of Europe will, to begin with, train at least 400 mediators in a first group of 15 member states this year. And I should like to thank publicly the Congress for the support it has already given to this initiative, notably by informing local and regional authorities about it and asking for their support. Regarding Roma mediators, I would like to draw your attention to two important points. The first is that we are encountering many mediators whose employment is precarious. In quite a few cases, they are employed on very short-term contracts or employed not by local authorities, but by associations or NGOs. I am convinced that Roma mediators are, in fact, a very important pragmatic tool for helping to ensure that basic public services are delivered to Roma communities. In other words, to help local authorities meet their responsibility to reach out to the population as a whole, without exception or exclusion. Through you, I would therefore plead that local and, where appropriate, regional authorities have recourse to mediators and to do so in a sustainable manner by providing more stable employment for them and recognising that this is a genuine profession. This is money well invested in social integration. Secondly, while I am convinced that appointing mediators and equipping them with the requisite professional skills is useful and necessary, it is not enough. Mediators will encourage Roma to knock on doors of local public services, but they cannot force those doors to open. As the saying goes, it takes two to tango. Hence the need to work with local authorities to achieve a better understanding of the role of mediators and how they can contribute to dialogue between the authorities and the Roma community, but also to counter prejudice and stereotypes vis-à-vis the Roma. As a first step, we are already associating local authorities with our ROMED training sessions in the different countries, but there is a clear need to go beyond this, as I will explain in a moment. Mr. President, members of the Congress, the high-level meeting of 20 October last year has created a new momentum and a dynamic in our action on Roma, and I am convinced that the Congress has an essential part to play. The high-level meeting underlined the key role of local and regional authorities in addressing the situation of Roma. To quote the Secretary-General, Mr. Torbjörn Jagland, during your plenary session of last October, he said, "You are at the forefront of the efforts to integrate Roma and travellers. It is at the local level where most challenges are, but it is also at the local level where best practices are found. We want to build on this precious work and experience and work with the Congress in order to achieve the critical mass of positive change." Speaking of best practices, we must remind ourselves that the picture is not wholly negative. As you said, Mr. President, several successful projects and initiatives have been launched in the last years at local and regional levels, which have achieved a better integration of the Roma into society. I will give you just two examples mentioned in an excellent document recently published by the European Parliament. Regarding employment, the Spanish project Acceder, developed by the Foundation Secretariado Gitano, has set up a network of employment services in 50 municipalities of Spain, addressed mainly, but not only, to Roma people. The involvement of local authorities and Roma experts in this project has helped to get jobs to 40,000 people in the last 10 years. This programme has been co-financed by the European Social Fund and the local and regional governments, which is a good example of cooperation between European funding and local involvement. Another example on healthcare. Romania has implemented a health mediators programme, which has increased Roma access to health services, as evidenced by an increased number of Roma patients enlisted in general physicians' practices and obtaining insurance cover at an increased rate of vaccination. Again, the involvement of local and regional authorities played a key role in ensuring the success of this initiative. In order to make a decisive move forwards, we need to build strong coalitions for change. This will undoubtedly require strong efforts by all concerned, not least the Congress and its national delegations, to mobilise local and regional authorities across Europe, to mobilise them into adopting policies and practices that actually work, to employ mediators, to end segregated schooling, to learn from each other's successes and failures, to learn how to handle and overcome popular anti-Roma sentiment, to involve the local Roma community in local policy making through dialogue and consultation, to increase their participation in local life, make municipal staff more attentive to the specific situation of Roma and practical ways to improve it, to mainstream the specific needs of Roma in the development of non-Roma-specific policies in areas such as spatial planning, housing, employment, education or healthcare, to mobilise and train local and regional authorities to submit projects for funding by the EU structural funds, and to be aware of the role that the Council of Europe Bank can fulfil in financing projects, including as part of a co-financing package for national contributions matching EU funds. There is definitely a vast potential for effective action through a European programme for mobilising local authorities and increasing their capacity to respond to the needs of the Roma communities so as to promote their social inclusion and the full respect of their human rights. I would suggest that the Congress is uniquely placed to take a lead role in this context. However, this mobilisation will not always be easy. It is one thing to build a European cooperation framework for municipalities that are already active in addressing the situation of Roma on the basis of the values and standards of the Council of Europe. It is quite another thing to bring in municipalities that may have been largely indifferent so far as to the fate of their Roma population, or even characterised by a climate of outright hostility to these populations. That said, these challenges should not prevent you from undertaking action. On the contrary, they are the key reason for taking action. William of Orange, better known as William the Silent, once put it very sharply. He said, "One need not hope in order to undertake, nor succeed in order to persevere." Regarding the Roma, we are not without hope, nor are we without any successes at all. On the contrary, the Council looks to the Congress for initiating a new dynamic in favour of Roma integration at local regional level, picking up on the new momentum generated by the high-level meeting. And I assure you that we stand ready to support your efforts in every way we can. I look forward to working with you in the months and years ahead. Thank you for your attention.
Mr. Schockenbrook, many thanks indeed for that intervention, and certainly we also similarly look forward to working with you further on this very important work. Our next speaker in today's debate is Professor Rudolf Schakosi from Austria. Professor Schakosi has worked ceaselessly to foster a better understanding of Roma and Sinti, to promote their rights and to combat the discrimination that they face. He led the movement for the full recognition of these communities as an ethnic group in Austria, which was finally achieved in 1993. He's been president of the Advisory Council of the Roma National Minority since 1995 and founded and is president of the Cultural Association of Austrian Roma. He served as a district councillor in Vienna from 2001 until last year, and also last year he was awarded the Golden Medal for services to the Republic of Austria. Professor Schakosi, we're very pleased you're with us and look forward to your contribution.
Recht herzlichen Dank, wertes Präsidium. Erstmals möchte ich mich dafür bedanken, dass ich als Angehöriger der Volksgruppe hier in diesem Haus eine Rede halten darf und aus der Sicht eines Betroffenen die Darstellung unserer Volksgruppe, aber auch einen Blick in die Vergangenheit zu machen. Und ich habe immerhin 20 Jahre Erfahrung in der Tätigkeit als Volksgruppenaktivist. Ich weiß, wie schwierig es ist, heute hier für unser Projekt zu werben, wenn in Nordafrika Kriege ausgebrochen sind und in Japan Atomkatastrophen und Erdbeben und Tsunamis große Opfer gefordert haben. Nun, in 2,5 Wochen Am 8. April feiern wir Roma den internationalen Roma-Tag. An diesem Tag vor 40 Jahren wurde in London der erste Roma-Weltkongress abgehalten. Es war dies die erste Zusammenkunft von Vertretern aus 14 Ländern, die auf ihre Situation aufmerksam gemacht haben. Es folgten einige gemeinsame weitere Kongresse, bis sich die Gründer außerstande sahen, dies weiterzuführen. Die politische Landkarte war damals ein anderes Europa. Es war aufgeteilt zwischen Ost und West. 1989 zerfiel diese alte Ordnung. Vor 22 Jahren wurden die Grenzen geöffnet, Mauern, Stacheldraht, Schussanlagen wurden entfernt. Neue europäische Länder entstanden. Feinde von damals sind heute im feindlichen Europa. Neue Staaten, die durch den Zerfall entstanden sind, wie in etwa die ehemalige Sowjetunion oder Jugoslawien. Einige dieser neuen Staaten kämpfen noch immer mit der Selbstständigkeit und Unabhängigkeit. Warum sage ich das? In diesen Ländern Europas leben überall Roma. Insgesamt mehrere Millionen, man spricht von 12 Millionen und mehr. Erfreulicherweise nahm der wirtschaftliche Aufschwung in der EU enorm zu. Auch in den neuen Ländern der EU. Nur die Situation der Roma blieb im Wesentlichen unverändert. Durch die EU-Erweiterung im Jahr 2004 wurden die westlichen und die reichen EU-Länder in die ärmliche Lage der Roma aufmerksam. Es war damals vor der Erweiterung sehr oft zu Gast in diesen Ländern Osteuropas als Referent und nach der EU-Erweiterung gab es nur spärliche Einladungen. In den vergangenen Jahren gab es vereinzelte Bemühungen, EU-Abgeordneten wiesen auf die Situation der Roma hin, leider mit mäßigem Erfolg. Ich bin seit 20 Jahren in Österreich als Roma-Angehöriger ein aktiver Volksgruppenaktivist. Politisch war ich 10 Jahre Kommunalpolitiker der Stadt Wien. 1993 erreichten wir die volle Anerkennung als Volksgruppe und damit den vollen Schutz durch die Republik Österreich. Unser Hauptaugenmerk liegt im Bereich der Bildung. 1993 gründete ich einen Bildungsfonds. Wenn wir heute mehr in die Bildung investieren, dann schaffen wir für unsere Menschen einen besseren Zugang in eine gesicherte Zukunft und sind nicht auf Sozialleistungen angewiesen. In Österreich haben wir kaum Probleme und wenn dann im Sozialbereich. Der Grund dafür liegt in den Versäumnissen in der Vergangenheit vor der Anerkennung als Volksgruppe. Eine weitere Ursache ist die Ausrottung durch die Nationalsozialisten. 90% meiner Angehörigen haben die Konzentrationslager nicht überlebt. Wir waren auch nicht organisiert und waren keine Ansprechpartner für die öffentliche Hand. Mit großer Sorge habe ich die Abschiebung aus Frankreich, die Räumung illegaler Siedlungen in Italien beobachtet, ebenso die Rückführung unserer Menschen in den Kosovo, die aufgrund ethnischer Vertreibungen ihre Heimat vor mehr als 10 Jahren verlassen mussten. Viele fanden in der Bundesrepublik eine neue Heimat und haben sich gut eingelebt. Nun werden sie aus Deutschland wieder in den Kosovo abgeschoben, wo sie vor dem Nichts stehen. Sie haben kaum eine Hilfe zu erwarten. Das Land ist aufgeteilt und Roma haben dort keinen Platz. In Österreich wurde ein Bettelverbot eingeführt, die das Betteln mit wenigen Ausnahmen verbietet. Es sind überwiegend Roma aus Osteuropa und den Balkanstaaten, die auf den Straßen stehen, keine österreichischen Roma. Wer beim aggressiven Betteln ertappt wird, bekommt eine Strafe von 700 Euro. Strafen sind schnell ausgesprochen, aber wo sind die Lösungen, um zu helfen? Dass die Ursache in der Armut zu finden ist, so nehme ich an, ist jedem bekannt. Abschiebungen und Strafen sind keine Lösungen. Jene Länder, aus denen sie kommen, müssen gemeinsam mit unseren Roma für eine bessere Lebensqualität sorgen. Wer verlässt schon gerne seine Heimat und seine Freunde? Sie sind Staatsbürger dieses Landes und werden im eigenen Land wie Fremde behandelt. Es gibt Roma-Dörfer oder Stadtteile in den größeren Städten, die sich Slum-ähnlichen Zuständen befinden, ohne Hoffnung auf eine bessere Zukunft. Lösungsvorschläge gibt es. In erster Linie denke ich daran, die Infrastruktur zu verbessern. Menschen, die keine besondere Ausbildung haben, könnten dort Arbeit finden, und das heißt in konkreten Infrastruktur. Straßen bauen, Wohnungen bauen, Wasser, Kanalisation, Abfallwirtschaft, aber auch Selbstständigkeit in der Landwirtschaft und in Kleinbetrieben. Das wären Lösungsvorschläge und besonders wichtig auch für das Selbstbewusstsein. Besonders wichtig ist der Bereich Gesundheit, Familienzuwachs, Altersversorgung. Kinder benötigen ganz besondere Aufmerksamkeit, damit sie eine Zukunft gehen können, wo sie nicht ausgegrenzt sind. Sie werden sich einmal als vollwertige Staatsbürger in Verantwortung für ihr Land übernehmen. Es gibt Roma, die sehr stark in den verschiedenen Projekten schon bereits erfolgreich arbeiten. Der Aufbau, der ist mir bewusst, ist eine harte Zeit für alle. Man könnte schon viel weiter sein, als es zurzeit ist. Man hat die Jahre seit der Öffnung der Grenzen mehr in die Roma-Volksgruppe hätte man müssen investieren. Wenn ich zurückdenke, war die Zeit des Aufnahmeverfahrens in der EU bis 2004, war ich ständiger Gast bei den Konferenzen. Heute reise ich nur mehr, wenn ich eingeladen werde. Eine Veränderung bei den Roma ist kaum ersichtlich, außer die freie Reisetätigkeit, die sehr viele nützen, um eine bessere Zukunft zu finden. Wenn sie als ethnische Gruppe aber erkannt werden, abermals werden sie dann verachtet und vertrieben. Die betroffenen Länder finden für alle eine Lösung, wenn es darum geht, die Wirtschaft zu retten, den Rettungsschirm über jene Länder zu halten, die von finanziellen Ruin stehen. Wenn es um die Wirtschaft geht, dann kennt man die Lösungen, was auch gut ist. Hier muss man zusammenhalten. Warum nicht auch bei der Verbesserung der Lebensumstände der Roma in Europa? Seit Jahren sind von einigen EU-Abgeordneten, so wie auch von mir, eine EU-Kommissar oder Kommissarin gefordert. Gefordert, um politische Verantwortung zu tragen. Das heißt auch, dass jene Länder, die sich nicht an die Abmachung halten, helfen, auch mit Sanktionen rechnen müssen. Ich habe es begrüßt, als die EU-Justizkommissarin Viviane Reding zu Maßnahmen in Frankreich im Sommer 2010 sich zu Wort gemeldet hat. EU-Kommissar Laszlo Andor hatte im Herbst 2010 in Wien, mit dem hatte ich ein sehr ausführliches Gespräch. Auch einen Brief an Frau Reding habe ich aufgrund meiner Erfahrung in der Roma-Politik mitgeteilt und meine Hilfe natürlich angeboten. Zu einer Erfolgsstory kann es nur dann kommen, wenn alle Beteiligten eingebunden sind. Bei uns Roma wird es darauf ankommen, wie die Vertrauensbasis in Zukunft aufgebaut wird. Denn bisher ist das Vertrauen nicht im gewünschten Ausmaß vorhanden. Viel Geduld und wird notwendig sein. Der Zugang wird von Staat zu Staat verschieden sein. Sie dürfen nicht erwarten, dass wir eine homogene Gruppe sind. Politisch treten sie kaum in Erscheinung. Ich persönlich bin zuversichtlich und glaube an den guten Willen aller Beteiligten, mit gegenseitigem Vertrauen Lösungen zu finden. Jedes Land braucht gut ausgebildete Menschen, vom Handwerker bis zum Wissenschaftler. Es ist Zeit, dass wir den dementsprechenden Platz in der Gesellschaft bekommen. Wir wollen mitgestalten und wir trauen uns auch höhere Aufgaben zu, auch diese zu übernehmen. Ich glaube, wir haben jetzt die größte Chance. Noch nie in unserer Geschichte hat es eine derartige Aufmerksamkeit gegeben wie jetzt. Ungarn, das zurzeit den Ratsvorsitz hat, könnte positive Schlagzeilen und wenn es sein Vorhaben für die Roma umsetzen würde. Bachtale.
Professor Sarkozy, thank you very much indeed for that contribution. Also, your personal experiences, I think, have been of great value to the Congress. So we really are delighted that you are able to be with us, and thank you for your contribution. Now I'd like to welcome our third speaker in the debate, Pilar Varela Díaz, who is the mayor of the town of Avilés in Spain, also the first woman mayor in the town's history. Ms. Díaz has been invited to speak about a very interesting point, a project that her town has implemented to eradicate shanty towns and to provide access for decent housing for Roma people. The project also implemented support measures to stimulate social inclusion, including encouraging access to education for Roma minors and access to the labour market for the Roma population. Other activities to promote intercultural coexistence have been organised as well. We'd be delighted that you're able to be with us, Ms. Díaz, and we very much look forward to your intervention. Thank you.
Avec les interprètes, parce que je ne parle pas le français, je suis espagnol, mais je viens essayer de le faire. Je viens ici pour parler de l'expérience de ma ville, de la ville d'Avilés. C'est une commune côtière du nord de l'Asturie. Avilés a une surface de 25 km carrés et une population de 85 000 habitants. L'expérience que je vais exprimer cet après-midi, ça veut dire une expérience depuis 20 années qu'on travaille avec les gitans. En Espagne, on appelle les Roms gitans, les gitans qui habitent à Avilés depuis le 1970 à Avilés avec nous. Et nous avons mis par ces politiques presque 11 millions d'euros. Ça veut dire que c'est une expérience qui continue dans le temps et qu'elle a besoin de beaucoup d'argent et beaucoup de décisions politiques. Je crois que c'est la première chose que je veux dire, parce que si on pense qu'on peut changer la situation qui vivent les personnes dans les bidonvilles seulement pour l'accès à l'allongement, je crois qu'on va, on ne va pas avoir d'exit avec son action. J'ai dit qu'Avilés, chez lui, dans les années 50, nous passons d'un pays agricole et d'élevage de quelques 21 000 habitants, devient Avilés un deuxième plus tard une ville à caractère sidérurgique industriel, dont l'importance croissance économique génère un fort mouvement migratoire non planifié et donc lié à la prolifération d'un urbanisme spéculatif et à la ségrégation socio-spéciale de la population qui en découle. La communauté gitane n'est pas étrangère à ce phénomène. Lorsqu'elle arrive à Avilés, elle s'installe sur sept sites de bidonville, à côté des quartiers nouvellement créés, dans des espaces périphériques souffrant d'une forte dégradation d'environnement, proche des voies de communication et abandonnées des points de vue urbanistiques. Ce sont 121 familles qui vivent dans des conditions d'hygiénique et de salubrité avec de graves problèmes d'accès aux ressources, au logement, à l'éducation, à la santé, à l'emploi, et sans aucun mouvement associatif propre. La crise économique des années 70 est suivie dans les décennies des 80 d'une importante restructuration industrielle. L'éradication de ville en ville, dans ma ville, et l'intégration de la communauté gitane s'imposent alors comme une préoccupation politique et sociale majeure. Dans ce contexte, des priorités sont établies, des actions sont mises en œuvre qui visent à progresser en matière de cohésion sociale et convivance entre habitants, Demythification des Stereotypes, Promotion du Respect et de la Toleranz et Connaissance, Enrichissement mutuel entre la minorité ethnique et la société majorité. En ce processus, nous avons fait des choses et après, nous avons rejeté expressément de les faire. Nous avons fait un cité promotionnel. Nous avons fait un bill seulement pour les gitans, pour 36 familles. On l'a mis comme relogement temporel, seulement pour 13 années, comme maximum, bien que certaines familles soient restées 10 années. Cette cité promotionnée, on l'a fini l'an 2007. Et nous avons aussi fait des accords avec la Fondation Secrétariat Gitan, les personnes qui ont parlé avec le programme ACEDER. C'est très important, le programme pour l'orientation et l'insertion professionnelle des collectifs gitans. Et pour nous, une des choses les plus importantes, c'est la constitution à l'essai de l'équipe municipale, à l'essai de la mairie, d'un groupe de travaux des minorités ethniques, composé par techniciens, par politiques, par organisations sociales et pour les associations de gitans. Le groupe a déterminé 28 initiatives dans les domaines du logement, de l'éducation, de la santé et de l'emploi. Notre expérience a été reconnue comme bonne pratique par Nations Unies avec les qualifications de BEPS et nous avons écrit aussi avec notre université un livre. L'objectif global de notre action, c'est l'éradication du bilan ville à village par l'accès à des habitations standards, à travers des mesures de soutien à l'insertion socioprofessionnelle de la population gitane et de la promotion de la convivance interculturelle. On a fait, je crois, les éléments déterminés de notre plan, c'est la mise en réseau des différentes entités publiques et privées, la participation des associations gitanes et de la famille concernée et l'implication de diverses administrations dans le financement et la succession du plan. L'avait à Avilés un consensus politique, tous les partis politiques nous sont en accord, et aussi un consensus social, avec des fondations, des secrétariats gitans, de la Croix-Rouge, de la Caritas, et aussi des associations de gitans. Et je dois dire que très important l'association des femmes gitans et des jeunes gitans. Aussi la représentation des familles, et aussi les organisations et les syndicats. Comme j'ai dit en avance, on a mis 11 millions d'euros, les 44% l'a fait la mairie et les 56% l'a fait le gouvernement de l'Asturie, le gouvernement régional. Le résultat de notre pratique, c'est l'abandon de la construction de quartiers à typologie spécifique, le relogement suivant des critères de dispersion géographique. 120 familles relogées dans des habitations dignes. Élimination de 7 bidonvilles. Davantage d'interaction et de convivance entre les paillos, c'est comment se dit les personnes qui ne sont pas gitans en Espagne et les gitans. Augmentation progressive de la normalisation sanitaire, sociale et éducative. La promotion du mouvement associatif spécifique, les jeunes et les femmes en particulier. Aider à la normalisation et à la continuité des processus d'accès au marché du travail de la communauté gitane pour les milliards d'itinéraires individuels d'insertion et amélioration des bilan urbains où s'installent les populations de bidonvilles et la mise en œuvre progressive d'une intervention intégrale sur l'exclusion. Et nous avons tiré beaucoup d'enseignements de notre pratique. Un des enseignements, c'est la large participation et le consensus social conjugué à la participation des personnes concernées multiplie l'efficacité des actions. Les travaux en réseau facilitent l'intégration du projet. L'implication de différents niveaux de l'administration donne au projet un caractère multidimensionnel et l'intégration des actions dans les plans plus larges favorise les travaux d'inclusion sociale. Surtout pour nous, on continue à travailler en ce moment et on dit que l'éducation, c'est le moyen expérience aussi l'éducation comme le moyen de cohésion sociale. Nous faisons des programmes d'ouverture des centres d'éducation à la communauté, programmes de prévention de l'absentisme scolaire et les programmes de l'éducation dans la rue. Et aussi des développements ordonnés et cohérents du territoire, avec des politiques actives de logement et collaboration avec les différentes administrations. Merci pour votre attention.
Well, Ms. Diaz, thank you very much indeed for your intervention, which effectively was a very practical case study of what local authorities can actually achieve working with communities. So that really has been, I think, extremely helpful to see how, in a practical way, local authorities can be involved in these issues. So we very much appreciate your intervention. The final speaker in our debate today is John Warmersham, who is our rapporteur. He was appointed in April 2009, and his mandate was renewed by the Congress Bureau last December. John continues tirelessly to promote the key role that local authorities play in fighting for Roma integration and to push for support and assistance for local and regional authorities' effort to implement policy initiatives. He represents the Congress at the Council of Europe Roma-related activities. He took part in the October high-level meeting for Roma, organised by Secretary-General Jagland. He comes from the United Kingdom. He isn't my neighbour. I come from the city of Manchester. He comes from the city of Salford, next door, and he is good and all round on every subject except when it comes to football, because as a Mancunian we have one football team that I support, which is Manchester City Football Club, and he supports another team that those of us who are Mancunian born and bred never ever talk about. John, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. President. President, colleagues, distinguished guests, can I just say a big thank you to those delegates that have stayed to listen to this debate, a debate that I believe is such an important human rights issue across Europe and beyond. Today I'm speaking to you in my role as thematic rapporteur on Roma and travellers. The Congress decided such a rapporteur was necessary in view of the growing concern about what is happening to Roma communities and the anti-Gypsyism which seems to be on the rise across Europe, not only amongst citizens but also in the discourse of elected representatives. Excuse me. As the President said, I was initially appointed in April 2009 and my mandate was renewed last December. I have been following the Council of Europe's Roma-related activities for some time now, and I am delighted that Congress has decided to highlight the problem facing the Roma population by organising this debate. I feel this debate is all the more important at the current time, not only because of the priority of Secretary-General Jagland is rightly giving this issue of Roma integration, but also in view of the declaration that was adopted last month by 60 or so mayors in the Czech Republic. The declaration was about measures widely seen as targeting the Roma population, which qualified them as socially inactable. I can but echo the statement by President Whitmore earlier this month and say that this sort of declaration runs counter to integration efforts, and such an attitude cannot be tolerated by the Congress. In countries across Europe, national strategies and policies have been drafted to address the situation of Roma and to promote their integration. However, it is at the local level where services are actually delivered and where action can be adapted to suit the local situation, which will be different from one town, even one neighbourhood, to the next. It is at the local and regional level that these policies and action are most effective and can be most effectively implemented. It is also at this level where citizens have easiest access to policymakers as well as to their rights. As such, local authorities have a key role to play in Roma integration, and they must increase their efforts to implement local policy initiatives which support the Roma. These key actions of local authorities must be driven by the basic principles of an equal society where people can live happily side by side. Accepting and understanding differences without seeing others as a threat. The new equality framework for local government for England and Wales defines an equal society as one that protects and promotes equal, real freedom and opportunity to live in a way people value and would choose, so that everyone can flourish. An equal society recognises people's different needs, situations and goals, and removes the barriers that limit what people can do and be. In my own city of Salford and in the President's city of Manchester, wherever possible, we actively encourage the development of strong and positive relationships between people from different backgrounds and promote meaningful dialogue and understanding between communities. Promoting the integration of Roma and thus achieving a cohesive society means improving Roma access to social rights such as education, decent housing, adequate health care and employment. It means empowering Roma so they can voice their needs and concerns and play an active part in civil society. For example, in associations representing their own interests and promoting their own culture. Integration also requires a legal and political cooperation framework within which all stakeholders participate on an equal footing and where common values can be negotiated and agreed upon. In this way, once citizens feel they are equal and have equal access to their rights, a greater understanding is achieved between all members of a community from all backgrounds. Stereotypes are broken down. Citizens can better engage in dialogue based on respect, and a more harmonious and comfortable environment is created. This debate today is being organised as part of the Congress contribution to the Council of Europe's action to combat the widespread discrimination against Roma and their social and economic marginalisation. Tomorrow, the Congress Current Affairs Committee, which is a very important committee because it has been set up to address the major challenges facing local and regional authorities, will hold a hearing on the situation of Roma in Europe. The committee will examine the action local and regional authorities can take to fight this discrimination and improve the integration of Roma. We will also discuss a proposal to set up a pan-European cooperation platform which will bring together mayors and representatives of city networks who are actively addressing the situation of Roma and who wish to join forces to cooperate and exchange good practices on the social and economic inclusion of Roma and travellers with other authorities across Europe. This framework will involve existing and emerging networks such as Romnet, Inclusive Cities, Eurocities, Intercultural Cities, the Strasbourg Club and CLIP, as well as national networks, and serve to coordinate the growing number of local and regional initiatives and activities in favour of Roma in Europe. The Congress already has some experience of this type of exchange and knows that its experience and know-how can prove very valuable, as there are some excellent innovative projects being implemented by local and regional authorities which need to be shared and learned from. I would urge our Congress members to get involved and spread the word about these activities, to send a message that intolerance towards and discrimination against Roma are not acceptable. We have heard today from our distinguished guests, Mayor of Avila, about the laudable project to eradicate shanty towns and to promote the social inclusion of Roma. We've also heard from Professor Sarkozy, who has had personal experience as a local elected representative, and I was pleased to hear about the setting up of the education, particularly around for young people, because I think actually educating young Roma is a real way forward. I also look forward to working with Mr Schoenenbrock as we move things forward for the Council of Europe, and I think that that's a real positive move. No doubt we will all find examples of good practice amongst the candidates in this year's Duster Congress Prize, which is awarded to municipalities that have implemented innovative and creative initiatives to effectively ensure the long-term integration of the Roma communities. Municipalities that respect the diversity of these communities and ensure their active participation in local democratic life. I urge all of you here to bring along your good practices too, and to commit to helping the Roma population of Europe. Our fellow Europeans, I am asking you to contribute to this pan-European response to meet the needs of the estimated 12 million Roma living in Europe. Ladies, gentlemen, colleagues, I thank you for your attention.
Well, John, thank you very much indeed for that introduction, and thank you for all the work that you do and are continuing to do. It is very much appreciated. I have a series of bilateral meetings that I have to attend, so I'm now going to hand over the chair to Dr. Von Staar, the president of the regional chamber. We open the debate. Colleagues, can I please ask you to be brief in the debate, though, because we will not be able to get through the full list of speakers, and it's not fair if you're not brief to be able to have them all speak. First on the list is Mrs. Koopmanschap from the Netherlands. The floor is yours. And Dr. Von Staar, the chair is yours. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. In the Netherlands, there are about 30 municipalities with Roma people. There are within 10 to 20,000 Romas in Holland. In some of the communities, not in all, but in some of the communities, there are some problems, mainly in the field of education, social work, youth, and healthcare. The particular problems are the high rate of unemployment and thus the dependency on social security, criminality, prostitution, discrimination and hindrance. Besides, there is a high rate of school absence, particularly from the age of 12 and above. In the Netherlands, the Ministries of Housing and Integration and of Education and Culture made available funds to municipalities to take on activities to tackle these issues. Despite their efforts, many municipalities have not yet succeeded in finding sustainable solutions to the problems. The Association of Netherlands Municipalities, the VNG, therefore created the Platform for Roma Municipalities in 2009. Currently, 12 municipalities participated in the platform and gathering both local elected officials and professionals. The platform supports municipalities in the exchange of knowledge and the coordination, intermunicipality cooperation and fundraising. Moreover, the platform serves as a joint voice towards the central government. The municipalities of the platform have made available extra funds to prevent dropout in school at an early age. Avoiding early dropout of school is the methodology of the Roma platform to finding answers to related challenges such as education, work and income, living conditions and criminality. The particular strength of the platform is it's looking for sustainable, practical solutions. Its strength is it really defines the issues and challenges to ensure that a real action plan can be developed towards improving the living conditions both of the Roma communities and the municipalities in general. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Kopmanschap. The next one is Mrs. Filahasari from Finland. Please, you have the floor, but only 2 minutes. I don't see Mrs. Filahasari, please.
Yeah. Mr. Chair, dear colleagues, I regret those empty seats and congratulate members present. We have heard excellent statements, and this issue is very current and important, and it's our priority. I'm from Finland, where our goal is that we will be a forerunner in promotion the equal treatment and inclusion of the Roma in Europe by 2017. Our government has adopted a resolution on guidelines to promote policy on Roma, and it will initiate intensified measures to enhance the inclusion of the Roma population at local level and to investigate their housing conditions. The government also wants to improve the status of the Romani language and increase the opportunities of the Roma children and young people for social participation and hobbies. Also, an international strategy will be drawn up in Finland to influence policies on Roma. The objective is to promote the inclusion and equality of Roma in various areas of life. Local and regional authorities, I think, will have a big role in implementing these measures in local level. We, your Finnish colleagues, are willing to report in the coming years about these actions in this field. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next speaker is Mr. Rogov from the Russian Federation.
Спасибо, господин председатель. Уважаемые коллеги, наверное, нет другой такой нация, которая бы так ассоциировалась с понятием миграции, как цыгане. Цыгане не только самое многочисленное национальное меньшинство в Европейском Союзе, примерно около 12 миллионов. Эта нация до сих пор сохраняет замкнутость и самобытность, выражающая в том числе стремление к перемене мест и непосредственном понимании права на свободу передвижения, перемещения. Их образ жизни входит в противоречие с общеевропейским пониманием статуса гражданина, который имеет не только права, но и обязанности. Возможно, поэтому проблематика цыган является поводом для наиболее острых дискуссий. Возможно, поэтому часты проявления непонимания и агрессии в отношении цыган не только со стороны местного населения, но и представителей власти. И примеры об этом сегодня уже упоминались, я не буду повторять. Именно на местном уровне эти проблемы непосредственно возникают и воспринимаются наиболее остро. Местные власти являются первыми, кто оказывается лицом к лицу с проявлением агрессии в отношении представителей той или иной национальности. Я думаю, что в обсуждаемом нами вопросе было бы интересно вернуться к опыту, который был накоплен в Советском Союзе по решению проблем цыган. 5 октября 1956 года был издан указ Президиума Верховного Совета СССР об приобщении к труду цыган, занимающихся бродяжничеством, который предписывал запретить цыганам заниматься бродяжничеством и перейти к трудовому оседлому образу жизни. Региональные власти обязывались принимать меры к расселению на постоянное место жительства цыган, занимающихся бродяжничеством, и их трудоустройству и культурно-бытовому обслуживанию. Конечно, такое решение воспринимается неоднозначно, особенно потому, что содержит прямой запрет на передвижение, что не соответствует демократическим принципам. Но в то же время оно содержит и положительные моменты, которые могут быть изучены и переработаны в соответствии с сегодняшними реалиями. В городе Покров проживает 10% от общего числа жителей цыганских семей. И на сегодняшний день это интегрированное сообщество в городскую жизнь, получающее все уровни социальной помощи, и особенно многодетные семьи. А большинство цыганских семей – это многодетные семьи. Это медицинское образование, это образовательные услуги. Есть и другие примеры решения вопроса. Например, в таких городах больших, как Липецк, где большое сообщество проживает на небольшой территории, имеются специальные школы в системе образовательной, которые дают возможность цыганам учиться, не развивая своих внутренних связей. Я понимаю, что 2 минуты очень мало для того, чтобы такой вопрос обсудить и сказать. Но я бы хотел сказать, что, наверное, единственным верным решением все-таки будет это интеграция цыганского населения в социальную жизнь того общества, в котором они живут. И тем самым решают проблемы, значит, их проживания совместно. Спасибо.
Very much. Please, the next is Pulido Valente from Portugal. Please, dear colleague.
Beaucoup, Monsieur le Président, Mesdames et Messieurs, chers collègues. Dans ma première fois que je parle dans une session plénière du Congrès, je vais prendre le risque d'être politiquement incorrect, mais mon expérience comme maire d'une municipalité avec depuis longtemps de bonnes pratiques en ce qui concerne l'intégration des Roms, reconnue par des prix des institutions internationales, me donne, je pense, la légitimité de vous présenter un nouveau point de vue. La situation des Roms en Europe n'est pas la même dans tous les pays et dans toutes les régions de chaque pays. Les problèmes sont différents, les solutions sont aussi différentes, même les Roms sont différents. Par exemple, dans mon pays et dans ma municipalité, à présent, et après une période de plusieurs années pendant lesquelles on a travaillé, regardant seulement les droits, on a fait une évaluation des résultats et on a conclu que cette perspective, peut-être perverse, ne résoudre pas le problème et par soi-même crée des conditions en extrême à l'intolérance des autres citoyens. Maintenant, on travaille en même temps les droits et les devoirs, avec la tonique sur la responsabilisation de tous ceux, Roms ou non, qui ont besoin et bénéficient de l'aide de la municipalité et de la communauté en ce qui concerne l'habitation, l'emploi, l'éducation, les appuis sociaux. Les résultats sont surprenants et nous incitent à continuer le même chemin. Dans cette perspective, je propose que le séminaire à organiser pour le Congrès analyse non seulement les questions des droits des Roms, mais aussi leurs devoirs, conditions fondamentales pour la pleine intégration. Merci.
Thank you very much. The next one is Mr. Akgun from Turkey.
Başkan, değerli hanımefendiler, beyefendiler, iyi akşamlar. Öncelikle romanlarla ilgili konuşmasına ötürü Sayın Profesör Sarkozy'yi tebrik ediyorum. Ve ayrıca romanlarla ilgili gündem yaratılmasında, kongreye bunun taşınmasında emeğe geçen herkesi kutluyorum. Ben Büyükçekmece, İstanbul'un batısında önemli bir ilçenin belediye başkanıyım. 4 dönemdir belediye başkanlığı yapıyorum ve ilçemizde de çok miktarda, belli miktarda Roman vatandaşlar yaşamaktadırlar. Özellikle Türkiye'deki Roman vatandaşların sayısının 2 milyon civarında olduğunu belirtmek istiyorum. Bu vatandaşlarımızın büyük bir kısmı sınır bölgelerinde daha çok yaşamaktadırlar. Yunanistan, Bulgaristan ve Romanya sınırı başta olmak üzere İstanbul'a doğru olan bir coğrafyada yaşamaktadırlar. Büyükçekmece ve İstanbul çevresindeki Roman vatandaşlarımızın hayat standartlarını yükseltmek, sosyal hayata daha fazla katılımlarını sağlamak üzere çeşitli hizmetleri birlikte yürüttük bugüne kadar ve özellikle iş, eğitim ve barınma konusunda özel projeler ürettik. Ve özellikle kentsel dönüşümle kendilerinin medeni anlamda yaşayabilecekleri konutlar ürettik. Ve bu anlamdaki çalışmalarımız devam etmektedir. Benim buradan kongreye söylemek istediğim şey şudur. Biz İstanbul Marmara Belediyeler Birliği olarak İstanbul'un Trakya bölgesi özellikle başta olmak üzere ilk önümüzdeki sonbaharda Roman vatandaşlarımızın sorunlarıyla ilgili ortak çözümler üretmek ve sürdürülebilir bir kalkınma yolunda daha neler yapabiliriz noktasında uluslararası bir konferans düzenleyeceğiz ve Sayın Profesör Sarkozy'yi de şimdiden iletmek isterim ki o konferansa davet ederek Roman vatandaşlarımızın bu anlamdaki yaşantılarını da yerinde görerek, Türkiye'deki Roman vatandaşlarımızın durumlarını bir bakıma yerinde inceleyerek yeni bir rapor hazırlayacağız ve bu kongrede rapor sonuç olarak gelecektir. Teşekkür ederim.
Thank you very much, Mr. Akgun. The floor has now Madame Merlot-Müller from France. Please, you have the floor.
Thank you. Monsieur le Président, dans le cadre de mes fonctions d'adjointe au maire d'Orléans, en France, j'ai eu l'occasion pendant 8 années d'exercer la présidence d'une association d'accueil des gens du voyage. Et c'est plus précisément des gens du voyage que je parlerai. Je voudrais remercier le Congrès pour son intérêt constant pour les gens du voyage et pour les Roms, et cela depuis la dizaine d'années où je siège au sein de cette institution. Permettez-moi aussi d'évoquer plus récemment l'engagement de Monsieur le Secrétaire Général, qui a montré une fois encore, à travers la nomination renouvelée de notre rapporteur, les intervenants qui ont siégé aujourd'hui, l'intérêt de notre Congrès pour ce sujet. Je veux dire 2 choses. La première, c'est que nous ne pouvons pas dissocier le local, c'est-à-dire l'engagement des collectivités, de l'engagement d'un niveau national sur un certain nombre d'affirmations de droits et de devoirs. Les collectivités locales ne peuvent pas tout si au niveau national, un certain nombre de restrictions aux droits et des personnes gens du voyage sont encore en activité. Je veux parler en France de la question du carnet de circulation, qui est une restriction importante à la citoyenneté des gens du voyage. La deuxième chose que je voudrais dire, c'est que je veux saluer l'action des collectivités locales qui nous a été largement présentée aujourd'hui et dire qu'elles ont un rôle essentiel à jouer, bien sûr sur le droit à l'éducation scolaire. J'avais eu l'occasion de monter de nombreux partenariats avec les écoles du quartier lors de cette présidence. Les droits aussi, l'exercice des droits sociaux fondamentaux, la question de la domiciliation quand on est gens du voyage est essentielle et relève effectivement de la compétence plus précisément des collectivités territoriales. Et enfin la question du logement dans lequel il est important que les collectivités s'engagent puisqu'il s'agit de penser des logements adaptés, ce qui est tout à fait aussi dans notre compétence. Notre combat pour la dignité et le respect des gens du voyage n'est pas terminé et nous comptons sur le Congrès pour poursuivre son engagement. Je vous remercie.
Vielen Dank. Es ist leider so, auch denn beim Vorsitzenden ist es so, den letzten beißen die Hunde, aber die Dolmetscher sind so freundlich, bis 7:15 Uhr noch hier zu bleiben und wir haben noch einen Punkt. Ich danke allen Rednern, vor allem auch für die Debattenbeiträge, für diese äußerst interessante Debatte und Redenbeiträge. Ich weiß, was alle leisten, insbesondere jene, die im Bereich der Roma, Kultur, Sozialarbeit engagiert sind. Alle, die in ihren Städten einen Beitrag leisten, seien auch hier vom Präsidium aus herzlich bedankt. Die Rednerliste ist nun geschlossen. Die Debatte zu diesem Punkt ist zu Ende. Vielen Dank. Wir kommen nun zum letzten Punkt der heutigen Plenarsitzung. Es ist die Debatte über die lokale und regionale Demokratie in Rumänien.